2020, which was a hazardous year with pandemic episode covering the whole world. Okay. Now today I will lecture about two German sociologists, two contemporary German sociologists, Ulrich Beck and Nicholas Luhmann. Now, why I brought them together? Now, one thing, of course, they are two German sociologists, contemporary German sociologists. Ulrich Beck is can be coupled with an Anglo-Saxon theorist, Anthony Giddens. Anthony Giddens's structuration theory and Ulrich Beck's risk society theory have similarities. Ulrich Beck's theory has also a similarity with Bauman, Bauman's uncertainty, the world, the global world becoming chaotic for the majority of the population, and of course for the few, the power and capital being in the global circuits, remember from Bauman. So there are some similarities there. In the case of Luhmann, there is a parallel between him and an American sociologist, Parsons, Talcott Parsons. Okay, now, as I said, Ulrich Beck was born in the middle of 40s, just the end of, it was 1 year before the end of Second World War, and we lost him in 2015. Now, he appeared in the scene of sociology, global sociology, with his book, Risk Society, Towards a New Modernity. Now, that is published in 1986, and in German, 1992 in English, and 2014, in Turkish. Now here, Ulrich Beck is also against using postmodernity like Habermas or like Giddens. Now, as you remember, Giddens divides modernity into modernity and late modernity. In late modernity, modernity became globalized. The four dimensions in the national modernity became global in the late modernity, in the global modernity. Now, Ulrich Beck chooses a different naming of these two periods. He names them first modernity, second modernity. Now, he differentiates the two in terms of risk. In terms of determination and uncertainty. Now, the first modernity, he says, in the first modernity, during the first modernity, there was a certainty in the population, in the societies, that the risk can be controlled, that natural disasters, events that will give harm to people, natural events that are hazardous, can be controlled by science and technology. Now, there was this certainty among the experts, among the scientific communities, and among the population. There was this expectation that there will be more and more progress. There will be greater control of nature, greater amount of production and welfare. And anyway, welfare society is being formulated during that period, welfare state. And parallel to that, a society which had somehow the guarantee that their social problems, even personal problems, family problems, will be solved by welfare state institutions. In the welfare state, in the first modernity period, weren't there any risks? Yes, there were risks, but these risks were conceptualized in such a way that they can be dealt with, they can be controlled. Something can be done about them. And that there was this expectation, this shared consensus, in a sense, that that, for example, risk can be secure. There are security, social security institutions, and hence, if you are security, social security, personal security, if you pay monthly amounts, when there is an unexpected calamity and an unexpected disaster in your personal life or family life or even the communities, and there was social security institutions which will provide solutions to it. For example, natural disasters in the first modernity period, whenever there was destruction as a result of an earthquake, the state was expected to provide houses, homes to the people. Now, in the second modernity period, this expectation from the state gave way to securing every family, every homeowner is asked to pay monthly allowances to the security earthquake security institution, insurance institution. So when you have the earthquake and your home is being destroyed, this insurance institution that you paid every month for it will give you the amount of money necessary for for building the house. So in Turkish case, it is being gradually being transferred from state responsibility to earthquake insurance institution responsibility and responsibility of the individuals, of the families, of the households. But in the West, or in the global sense, even insurance institutions are not anymore willing to insure your houses or your lives or whatever. You know, there is this, according to Beck, in the second modernity period, the security institutions, insurance institutions, are not anymore or are not as in control of risk situations, hazardous situations, as they were in the first modernity period. Huh? Now, in the first modernity period, there was planning on the basis of rational and scientific knowledge of experts and 5-year plans. All countries, for example, Turkey had its 5-year plans during after the Republic, and then it was gave up during 50s, and then after 60 again there were 5-year plans. And now planning the economy and planning technological development, not in the first modernity, was based on faith on scientific knowledge, scientific technology, and on the basis of that information, that knowledge, planning the economies, technologies, society, and building institutions to control unexpected disasters, unexpected risks. Now, some societies, as you know, in the first modernity period, the world were divided into three worlds. The first world, the capitalistic world, or central capitalist countries. There was a second world, socialist bloc, and a third world. Now, in the socialist bloc, this planning was almost a totalistic type of planning, planning every aspect of economy, every aspect of society, of settlements. Instead of mechanisms of the market mechanisms, their planning, central planning, replaced market mechanisms. Whereas in the first world, and in a mixed way, in the third world, the market mechanism was dominant. Planning, it was there, especially with the welfare state, but it was secondary in comparison with the socialist socialist world. Now, that is the first modernity. Now, as you have seen, and there is a risk calculation. An industrial society is ready to calculate the risks, and all insurance companies actually, based on that rational calculation of the risk. And that was the mathematics of this calculation. Probability statistics emerged during 18th century, 19th century, and during 20th century, it was full blown. All the calculation of life tables, life expectations, how many years a cohort of population will, etc., etc. You know, these were all controlled, all plannable, controllable at least, if not controlled. But in the second modernity period, suddenly new events started appearing in the 90s as the second world socialist bloc disintegrated. It was not anymore, there was not anymore a Soviet socialist republics. Now, parallel to that, but independent of that, the degree of technological control started contributing to the emergence of unexpected and uncontrollable events. Now, what happened, for example, it was discovered that the ozone layer in the atmosphere, there are some holes in it, which is lethal in some respect for the health of the people, for the health of the living beings. And then even before the dissolution of Soviet Socialist Republics, there was a Chernobyl event, a nuclear plant exploded, a nuclear plant exploded, and it influenced such an area. Now it was a marvel, you know, building nuclear plants to produce electricity independent of coals or of petroleum, clean energy. It was, you know, in the first modernity, building nuclear plants to produce energy, electrical energy. You know, it was a utopia, but suddenly a big plant exploded, and that in the minds of people globally alarmed. Now, that was not the only event. There were other events. For example, some viruses started emerging, chicken virus, or some animals were mass killed because there was a disease. It was something in the brain because of the whatever they were being fed. There were that thing. The chicken pox, ozone depletions. It was discovered that under the oceans there were millions of tons of plastic. All these, of course, we shouldn't forget about atmospheric scientists, meteorologists, I couldn't pronounce the word, meteorologically, it was discovered that Earth was getting hotter and hotter every year, giving rise to depletion of ice blocks in the poles of the Earth, and hence the oceans and the seas, the sea level was going to rise, giving rise to some settlements being under the sea, the eventual result of all this melting of the ice blocks could lead to covering settlements with sea, with ocean. All those settlements along the seasides, and the possibility. Still, we are expecting such events. This is the second modernity. So with this, all these events and the expectation of the people started changing. Expectation from technological change, from science. Now the reliance on experts, on scientists, started declining, and instead of thinking about progress, continuous betterment of life, of economic production. So there was not anymore a progress or a decline, but a spreading of uncertainty and risk, and the second modernity. Of course, the pollution again, now that we are polluting our own environment, and of course the air, the atmosphere pollution, somehow continually we are all our activities, transportation activities, production activities, all those agricultural production, all those activities contributing to the pollution. So to what extent pollution can be controlled, especially pollution on the basis of the use of carbon containing materials of like coal or petroleum or other materials. And gradually people started asking the producers, big corporations, since their production is contributing to the pollution and destruction, in a sense, eventual destruction of the life on Earth, and they should be responsible from their commodifying. Okay, that is what commodifying of nature, commodification of nature, which raised the threat of destroying life on Earth. Now, the first response years ago, when, for example, there are the nuclear plant from nuclear the material from nuclear plants that should be gotten rid of, they were dumped into some third world countries. Now, it was discovered that those dumped materials, eventually, their effects strike back. He called it boomerang effect. I don't know whether there is this this play instrument. You throw this instrument to the air, and it comes back to you. You throw it, So the material, the instrument ill, is built in such a way that it comes back. And it is a good play activity, like a ball, or playing with a ball. But the coming back of what you throw to yourself, in the case of destruction of nature, it's obvious. And it will come back and will envelop all the world. We are in the same ship. The perception of the fact that we are in the same ship. If the ship is sinking, we will all sink. That kind of an expectation. Now, Beck calls this a kind of, like Giddens, reflexive returning, reflexive looking back on our activities. Reflexivity, rational reflexivity of at the individual level, and hopefully at the institutional level, hopefully at the state level, and at the global level. If this reflexivity increases, a reflexive looking back at ourselves, our activities, our production, our consumption, especially with the development of a consumption society where dynamics of the society shifted to the consumers, how consumers can be tricked into buying, although they don't need it, tricked into buying unnecessary items, throwing away the previous ones, and that dynamic. Especially younger people started looking at themselves and started controlling their consumption behavior. They stopped that seduction of the market, of the ads, advertisements. Sociologically, as Beck says, as it is also being said by others, by Bauman or Bourdieu pointed that out, how in the second modernity, other people named it in a different way, in the late modernity of Giddens or second modernity of Beck, seduction of the consumers. From Bauman. Bauman said in the solid modernity, it was more a hierarchical, bureaucratic control, determination. But in liquid modernity, people were left free as if. But now they are seduced. Instead of being controlled, but they are left as individuals, individualized society. But in terms of consumption, they are being seduced to be consumers, or a section of population is being seduced to be consumers. But a large sectors of the populations in the world are left to their own fortunes. And that was a similar conclusion is being reached, a similar conclusion that Bauman reached. As a matter of fact, Bauman uses Beck's risk society approach in his books. He give references to Beck. So Beck and Bauman, which one is earlier writing about this risk society? I think Beck is earlier, and Bauman gives reference to Beck's books. But there's as you can see, there is a parallel in their conceptualization. Okay. Towards the end of 90s, back together with his wife, so Beck and Beck Gernsheim, they focused more on family relationships, individual relationships in risk society. And they wrote this book, The Normal Chaos of Love, in 1995. And then they wrote, before he died in 1915, in 1913, they wrote Distant Love. Now, in these two books, they talk about globalization of love, if you like, globalization of human relationships, how love and freedom in these risk society conditions in global society are related, how as divorce increased in societies, what are the results of this? So the uncertainty that increased at the societal level reflected itself at the household level, at the family level, and hence now what will happen to the children? How those who are, you know, a new type of family emerged, single parent families, a parent and a child. What kind of phenomenon is this? Now, in the first book, in the Normal Chaos of Love, how as the traditional is being left, the first modernity conceptualization of marriage, love, raising of children on scientific basis. There were all those books in the first modernity, how to educate children, how nuclear families should behave. But now in the second modernity, as divorces increased and as marriages postponed, and as population increase decreased, so a chaotic situation emerged. Now Bauman uses that chaos at the global level, global chaos and local order. Now Beck and Beck here in the Normal Chaos of Love, bringing that global chaos to the local, to the family, the chaos in the local, chaos in the global, and chaos in the local. Now in their last book before Beck died, in this Distant Love, they started talking about global family, how in terms of if we think of the child, how one parent is from one country, say from the West, and the second parent is from third world, or if the parents are from the same country, the person that is giving child care, where woman is professionally working. Now, child care is provided by people coming from other countries, usually from third world countries. As you know, in Turkey too, people from Turkmenistan or Kazakhstan or Kyrgyzstan or Azerbaijan, people, women, come to the families as child care personnel, or as helping in the chores of the household, where the woman in the household usually is working outside, usually professionally. So in the second book, in Distant Love, they talk more and more, more and more about this, and how one household, one family, one nation, one identity gave rise to hybrid identities, hybrid families. Now the families with different cultures, different values about marriage, actually, different values about child raising. So that's really an interesting book they have written. And I put here a review article of this book by some people. They are assessing their conceptualization of this global families, bringing partners from the different countries and different cultures, different, in a sense, in the societies, we know that traditional values, modern values, and postmodern values, all they are mixed at the global level and at the national level. But now, back, focused on at the family level, and how all these three different types of values, conceptualizations, the conceptualization of action, traditional action, rational action, instrumental, rational, emotional, remember from Weber, now how all these different value conglomerations, value complexes, okay, let's call them, come together in the cosmopolitan family, cosmopolitan global family. And they predict that there will be more and more of this type of pardon, families in the future. Okay, I think this much will be enough about Beck. Now I will go into Niklas Luhmann's theory, and then I will expect from you some feedback. But if you have questions about Beck's theory of risk society, of global family, of distant love, then you can ask them here. Are there any of you who have questions or feedback? There are, it seems, not now. Hopefully, at the end, you will ask some questions or give some comments. Okay, now, Niklas Luhmann, as I said at the beginning, is a theorist of systems, social systems. Now, you are exposed to systems theory and its application into societies in your second year when we were assessing Talcott-Parsons theory. Talcott-Parsons theory, although at the beginning it was more action and interaction based, eventually it become a social systems analysis. a systems systems and subsystems analysis. Now, Niklas Luhmann is a student, actually, of Parsons, but he developed some new conceptualizations, that were prevalent in biology, for example. Now they try to apply that conceptualization into sociological analysis. Now, the concept is autopoiesis. Autopoiesis. Now, autopoiesis, auto, you know, from automobile, auto, or autonomy. Now, in automobile, a car that is moving by itself. The energy is in itself. It is not like a cart, an oxen-driven or horse-driven cart. There is a horse or ox driving the vehicle. But with automobile, the vehicle itself is moving, so automobile. Now, in autonomy, ruling by self, by himself, herself, autonomy of a nation or autonomy of a person, autonomy. Remember from relative autonomy, the concept of relative autonomy from Althusser, again, from your second year sociological theory course. Now, instead of determination, economic determination of political structure, how political structure has a relative autonomy. It has its own dynamics. It rules itself. Autonomy. Now, auto poiesis. Auto poiesis. Poiesis here actually comes from meaning. Now there's a story by the a biologist, a doctor, who first coined this concept, created this concept to explain how cells, nervous system, brain work. They work by themselves when without any intervention and control from outside, how brain or how cells and organs they are working. He expressed with this autopoiesis and how he developed this concept. He was talking with a friend of his who wrote a paper, an article about Don Quixote. You know the novel, the chivalrous man, Don Quixote in Turkish. How in the beginning of the book, he's contemplating whether he should go in the direction of praxis, action, or in the direction of poiesis, praxis or poiesis. Now, praxis, okay, taking the horse and your sword and whatever, and going to the war was one choice. The second one was poises going into letters, into literature, into life of meaning. Now, from that, while discussing that, and he was thinking about the cells and brain, and suddenly he realized that this poesis here and auto poesis, how meaning is created by itself, regulated by itself, a new level emerges with the mechanisms in itself without an outside intervention. Now, Niklas Luhmann thought that this concept can be applied to societies. Societies, actually, he formulated at three levels. Societies, social interaction, the level of interaction, or interaction order, from symbolic interactionists, interaction order, societies, interaction order, and no, then he divides into subsystems, that is differentiation of the social system into legal subsystem, family subsystem, economy subsystem, and science subsystem. Okay, now social system divided into these four subsystems. Now remember, in Parsons, social system was divided again into four, but into a different type of four. Now here it is, family, legal system, economic system, and scientific system. In the case of Parsons, social system was divided into, again, economic system, it was there, political system, societal community, the third one, the integration. There he divided these into four on the basis of the functions they serve: adaptation, goal attainment, integration, and late pattern maintenance, latent pattern maintenance, remember. And at the fourth level, there was what we called fiduciary. But here, economy is common. Now, fiduciary, the scientific system, and the fiduciary of Parsons, there are some similarities but differences, because their educational system is in the fiduciary of Parsons. Here, science system. Now, these subsystems are, like the social system, are also working with autopoietic, poietic mechanisms, autopoietic mechanisms. So this is the social system. The interaction system, two person, three person, their interaction is also autopoietic. A friendship regulates itself. Is now the concept he uses is self-referential. Of course, there are some interventions sometimes from outside, but how now, if an interaction system became an autopoietic system, it deals with the external interventions by including it, or by drawing a boundary and excluding it. Okay, now, I said at the beginning that Niklas Luhmann conceptualized this autopoietic self-referential systems at three levels, at the societal level, at the interaction system level, and at the psychic level, or at the personality level. Now, Parsons formulated that personality system and subsystems of the personality system. Luhmann does not use personality system, but psychic system, a psyche emerging over the nervous system, brain, but being autonomous, autopoietic, an autopoietic system emerges on organism. Organism is, according to Maturana, is also autopoietic. But Luhmann thinks that psychic system is also autopoietic. Now, these psychic systems interact with each other in the interaction order, and that emergent interaction order is also autopoietic, regulating itself, being self-referential. And then at the societal level, society, or even he formulates that the global society as well, when it emerges, will be autopoietic. Now, the initial starting actually was a synthesis of, again, you will remember from your second year, a phenomenological approach to meaning, meaning creation of new meanings, and system approach. Now, autopoiesis, as you remember from Maturana's experience of the Don Quixote facing a choice between two paths, and deciding about one path, excluding the other path. Now, Nicholas Luhmann says that social systems also continually decide about these types of bifurcations, dual choices. For example, legal code chooses between legal and illegal, whereas art code chooses between aesthetic and non-aesthetic. Political code is choosing between power and opposition. Power and opposition. Now, Nicholas Luhmann says that every system is based on these kinds of codes, and they only see what is being coded. They are blind. They are blind to uncoded aspects of life. They can only foresee or control what its codes make observable. Now, social systems, since they are autopoietic, they also create their own observation. Now, actually, what Luhmann is saying is that sociology is actually an autopoietic result of a type of social system, modern social system, modern societies, evolved to such a level that they became autopoietic. They started regulating themselves self-referentially, differentiating, integrating themselves. This autopoietic processes started being dominant in certain types of society in terms of historical evolution, they also started giving rise to an autopoietic self-observation, returning onto itself and producing its own knowledge. Of course, this is he thinks that we have to conceptualize societies historically from segmented, remember, from Habermas or from others, from segmented communities in Luhmann's formulation to center-periphery differentiation, the second one. Third one, stratified societies. Now, fourth one, societies with functional systems. Societies with functional systems become autopoietic. And as societies are in this fourth stage, as they became functional systems, they also create their own observation autopoietically, and sociology emerges out of this. This is really interesting formulation, because it makes sociology a kind of self-knowledge of certain type of societies. Inevitably it emerges. It is going to be a social system, an autopoietic social system. To reiterate, now I have to say that an autopoietic system involves, what are the elements that it involves? Of course, it involves action, meaning, and communication. Now, for Luhmann, communication is very important for Habermas. In terms of Habermas's formulation of systems and Luhmann's formulation of system, there is some similarity. But Luhmann, Habermas and Parsons does not use the concept of autopoiesis, whereas contrasting with them, Luhmann uses biology's biologically invented concept of autopoiesis and applies it to social systems. Now, as social systems are conceptualized as autopoietic systems, they involve action, meaning, communication, system communication, and distinction. Okay. In the communication, as communication is very basic building block of autopoietic systems, in the communication there are threefold process according to Luhmann. One is utterance. Now, in a communication, assent, for example, in person-to-person communication, a sentence is being uttered, a word is being uttered. It is being said, it is being pronounced, it is thrown. The second one, it involves some kind of information, the utterance, information, and understanding. Now, of course, in real life, these three are combined. They are one. But analytically, analytically, Luhmann divides them, divides this unity into three as utterance, information, and understanding. And how through communication, social systems are autopoetically, self-referentially organized. And in order to be an autopoetic social system or system, how they maintain their closure, establishing boundaries. He calls them operational closure. In order to be an autopoietic system, it should have an operational closure to prevent external interventions. So it is not heteronomy. His external control is being excluded. Now, Luhmann's theory is indeed a complex theory. Now, he started explaining this in his first book, Theory of Society or Social Technology. And the subtitle was, What is the Use of System Research? At that point, it was not fully formulated. Now, that is the beginning of the 70s. Now, by 1984, social systems was already conceptualized. In 1990, Political Theory in Welfare State, in that book, he formulated his theory further into a further stage. And in 1997, he wrote this book. Now, this is really very interesting for me. And the German title of the book is very interesting. Die Gesellschaft, der Gesellschaft. Now, remember, you're from your first year sociology. Yeah? We start talking about community and society. In Turkish, or in Turkish, we say topluluk ve toplum. In Ottoman, we say cemaat, cemaat, cemiyet. Now, in German, it is Gemeinschaft and Gesellschaft. Now, Gemeinschaft is Ottoman cemaat, Turkish topluluk, English community. Gesellschaft is this more complex one, rational one. Tönnies, Tönnies, Gemeinschaft and Gesellschaft. Now, Luhmann is talking about Gesellschaft of Gesellschaft. Die Gesellschaft, der Gesellschaft. Now, I don't know German very well. I had one or two semesters of German. Society of society. Now, if you, this society of society. Now, kind of, one is a society which developed its own autopoetic observational knowledge producing dimensions, producing knowledge of itself. Die Gesellschaft, der Gesellschaft. That is really the next year, 1 year later, he died anyway. This is his last book. And as usual, I have personal experiences, as you know, with theorists. Some of them, as I told you, I met in a conference, or I listened to in a conference, or Anyway, you know, with Nicholas Luhmann, Luhmann's book, I had an experience with Nicholas Luhmann, Social Systems. Now this 1984, which it was translated in 1995. So it should be in a conference in England or in Germany. I don't remember now, but I am in a university bookstore where there are so many books in sociology and other fields, other disciplines, other sciences. And here, there is this book, Social Systems. Now, should I buy it or shouldn't I buy it? Now, how many books I can buy with the money I have? And with, of course, the suitcase, the kilogram of the suitcase for the plane, etc. And I didn't buy it. Now I'm later. I am still thinking that why didn't I buy it? I feel guilty about it, or about not buying it, not having that book. I had a similar experience with another book. That was, I remember the bookstore. It was in London. There was a three-volume book about Massignon's book about Hallaci Mansur. Hallaci Mansur is a Muslim thinker who is being killed because he said en el hak. Now, Massignon, a French sociologist, social scientist, a friend of Lefebvre, actually, a sociologist we already covered from France, wrote a three-volume book about Hallaci Mansur, a three-volume book. Now, I said, should I buy it? Three volumes? Shouldn't I buy it? How can I carry it, etc.? I didn't buy that book too, and I became I accused myself that I didn't buy it, that I should have bought it. So Luhmann's book Social Systems had a similar fate. The Massignon's book was earlier episode. This was a second episode. A third episode, since I started, let me tell this third story, a similar story. I was in a meeting in Egypt, and the first part was in Cairo. And then with a friend and with a driver, we will go through the desert. And we will go to Alexandria at the seaside, Alexandria. Now, towards the middle of this road, we stopped somewhere. You know, it was not a village, but there was some historical monument. As a matter of fact, there was some Ottoman historical monument. And there was a church somewhere there. And there was this cassette. About Byzantium chantings. I said, should I buy this or shouldn't I buy? And then I didn't buy it. And later, again, I asked myself why I didn't buy it. That was the first episode, as I remember now, Massignon second one and Nicholas Luhmann third one. So, friends, if you have the possibility of buying something like this, a book or a cassette, something that you will miss later, that you will accuse yourself of not buying, do that. Okay, that is the lesson that will be drawn from my threefold experience. Okay, I think I will stop here. And ask you your comments or